Say hello to the
starting to the top left, starting for Team MVP, we now have a super, formerly known as a vampire. Guess I kind of spoiled that a little bit.
MVP Super!
Really good record in Heart of the Swarm so far against Terran players. He won every single match, and not only his best of threes, but also every single map that he played against opponents like Cop, Lemon BB, and Gumiho. So not the strongest opponents that he faced so far. Now he's up against a Prime player, starting to the bottom right of the map here on a killer. We have
Bjorn Prime.
I want to give a shout out to a website that I just found recently that I think is awesome. And it's called Ali Gulak. I think is the best way to say it in a way you might understand. I tweeted about it earlier, so you can go to my Twitter at ProxyWolf and look at the link there if you don't know how to spell that. But it's a ton of information there, a great database for Heart of the Swarm. Very, very quickly updated on what matches are happening. A cool rating system as well, but there's a ton of information about the players, the teams.
Yeah, I've been using those guys for a long time. They actually have a really, really interesting filter system as well, which helps you quite a lot for these things.
Yeah, definitely recommend checking that
it's
out.
It's also being used by a lot of people actually that bet on StarCraft. There's several sites where you can do that, and they have interesting predictions heading into games. That's actually one of the main features that they have, that you can pin two players up against each other, and then they find which kind of best-off system they are playing to get like an idea of how probable it is that one of the teams winning. They also have been posting quite a lot in the Team Liquid threads for a long time right now to give an idea of how likely it is that a player will advance.
Yeah.
In the match itself, we now have the first Reaper being started, by the way, for Bjorn, who took the gas early on. Has still two of his SCVs in the gas, so didn't pull out after that.
Right, so the two in the gas means he's probably going to go into a reactor expand after this. He just wants to have a little bit more mineral income to get that. And you know, every five minerals, every trip the SCVs take really starts to add up. So you know, even though it looks like it's insignificant, he only has one out of that, it actually helps him get a command center much faster. You see he can move the SCV over there right away, even before he starts the reactor here.
First Reaper is now out, and we have immediately the reactor dropped, and of course also the command center has now been started. Roughly at the same time that we see the Nexus for Super. And the MVP player, of course, very strong just recently in the GSTL. Not only performing all kill, but then going for that spin kick. It was pretty awesome to observe. Spin jump kick, actually.
Yeah.
So that was quite artistic. Now let's see if he has reason to perform that again today, or if he will drop down to Corday in this group.
Yeah, that's what we'll find out very shortly here. He's going to get scouted, but with the Mothership Core already out, the Reaper is going to hightail it out of here. He gets the information he wanted. He does not, however, know if there's going to be a Robotics or two Gateways going down, or even perhaps, you know, the Stranger case, the Stargate.
Reaper still trying to get those scouting information, and the problem really is that he has a very limited surface area where he can jump up into the main base with the Mothership Core already guarding this, and the Stalkers of course now guarding the edges. It's not going to be easy for him at all. Probably just keep that for later and try to find out if there's a third base or even a fourth base being built.
Yeah.
But at this point, he cannot really achieve a lot with it.
He checks for proxies with it, takes the Watchtower, but that's all he can really do.
Yeah, scout the map, get the map control, and that's kind of it for now.
Back at home, Widowmine production has started, so he's going to have some delayed aggression possible with this. There's the starport to be able to lift those.
A few Marines at the front, and what we've seen a lot in this matchup is actually the Terran player trying to be quite aggressive, not only when he has the medevacs out, but even before they're trying to hit those Marine timings. But Bjorn plays a bit of a different style here. He wants to go into drops, and we have him already with a Widowmine being built, so he's not going for this very early engineering bay that we have and going into the plus one attack upgrade or anything like it. We'll move out with his Marines and then just use that Widowmine to be a bit more aggressive. Maybe place at the front, trying to bait a Stalker here, waiting of course for the medevac. And this Reaper actually is able to sneak into the main base. Not quite sure he was able to dodge everything here, but he gets the perfect read on what exactly Super is up to in his main base.
And not only that, but he draws these units into the main base. They're going to come back down right away. They need to, because there's a Marine pressure coming out here. And this is what the reactor expand allows you to do, is just get these Marines out and try to trade and maybe even knock down a sentry. He's got the Widowmine with this directly, so he could bait, and he has to protect it against the Observer. He knows the Observer's there now. He has to walk away. That's fine. But this is a very, very, very quick third base that Bjorn does not know about.
7 minutes. That is like one of the earliest third bases that he can actually get against Terran. Really early in the game here. But this already so means that his units will be pretty spread out. He takes down the Observer, and this is a big problem for Super. Now he needs to get another Observer, has it already on the production queue, and he has also a second one still on the map. So he has detection, and he's going to be safe with this, but still, with all those Widow Mines then around later on, he needs to be careful where he positions them.
Yeah. This is shaping up to be a really interesting game. Bjorn needs to get that information about the third base, and he will. This is a very big risk that Super is taking, just simply because... nice step on the Widowmine there. Just simply because he's going into this with a robotic support bay too. He doesn't have a lot of gateways to defend. And here comes the drop on the main base. He's got one Widowmine in here.
Immediately, of course, a photon overcharge being faded out here. And Medivac trying to retreat, leaving the Marine behind once again.
His
we
arm was like...
so not on...
This is not Ohana, for sure. I love the Marine's arm. It just looked like he was reaching out to the Medivac, like, why didn't you pick me up?
You know, if that was Mission Impossible, the Marine would just have jumped over the cliff and grabbed onto the Medivac. But of course, he's not Tom Cruise, and therefore he can't do that.
Yeah, no Scientologist Marines here.
Yeah. Can't fly yet.
No, Scientologists aren't allowed to become Marines, I heard. Only in movies.
Well, the thing is, like, maybe if they're really good Scientologists, that spaceship comes a little bit earlier and saves them, but that
only if they're really, really good Scientologists.
But that Marine definitely was apparently not a very good follower.
He didn't do, you know, his duties.
Yeah, he didn't go from door to door on a Sunday and try to sell the Watchtower.
Exactly.
Or hand it out.
Oh, by the way, this pressure here... He doesn't have a lot of room to run with, and he did bait out that overcharge earlier, so the Mothership Core not ready to help out. And this is part of the reason why this is such a risky third, just simply because he doesn't have any units here.
And he doesn't have any wiggle room here. Big problem with that cannon blocking the way, and two of the Stalkers are dead, and now the Marines are trying to take down a few of the Sentries. That's a lot of damage done. He could actually try to target down the probes instead of focusing the Nexus.
Widowmine here at the natural. He's already killed a few probes, and the Widowmine is going to stay a little bit longer, most likely.
A lot of pressure here on Super. Bjorn is really doing a lot with these few units, getting another base behind it, and he has still units everywhere on the map, but only four workers killed.
Yeah. Colossus has taken a hit on that Widowmine, though. Down to 190 hit points now. No shields.
Yeah, he definitely had a problem there at the third base. He didn't target those probes. I think he right-clicked on the Nexus, and therefore only damaged a few of the shields, but he could have destroyed a lot of the workers.
He also killed the cannon instead of just ignoring it and going for the probes. But there's only one Stalker here, and Super is neglecting his defenses right now.
Yeah, this time we have a lot of harvesters being killed. I mean, look at this, from 4 to 8.
He should have pulled his probes away. I mean, Bjorn had a late third, so this kind of equalizes. It doesn't put him in a massive lead or anything, but this is what he needed.
Yeah, from 4 kills earlier into 8 additional ones, so 12 in total. That definitely paid off for Bjorn here. That was a really good focus that he had there, making sure that he targeted down all those probes one by one. And now we still have that Medivac being a threat, but the two Stalkers pinning it down. But Bjorn is already moving out with another Bio Force, and Super at some point will have to use those two Stalkers, and then the Medivac might be really valuable to him again.
Yeah. The Medivac just always lurking. This is... Oh no! He needs a split, but that Colossus looked like it was on move command there for a moment.
Yeah, but with double Colossus it shouldn't matter, but he's targeting it down, or at least he's trying to. But he cannot really do a lot with this. But just the pressure alone that we've seen executed by Bjorn so far, that's quite amazing. Super with these, a very decent defense though. The only problem that he really has was with the last Medivac that came in and took down those additional harvesters. But if you ignore that, his defense is not shabby at all. I mean, the guy is going into +2/+2, has a little bit of an upgrade lead over Bjorn. We have him also with a range upgrade for the Colossi. He's going into additional ones. Oh, actually, he doesn't have the range upgrade. Sorry. Has two Colossi, but didn't get range.
He did not get it. He skipped it. Right now, Bjorn is... I love how he's played this game, because he didn't say, oh no, you have a fast third, I need to all in here. He's just putting constant aggression on, trading against the Zealots, trying to pick off the Colossi, going for all these crazy drops, which are, in fact, risky. But the way he's played this game is just saying, I'm going to catch up against your base. I'm actually going to do that with my aggression. And he's going for another drop. Good Observer spread, though, by Super. He has one on the left side and the right side. He will see this coming.
As said, his defense is really good. I mean, he has Stalkers in the main base now. We have him still without the range upgrade. He's going now into a few mortars and a massive amount of gateways now coming up, whereas he is transitioning into the Temple Archive to get those storms out. The attempted snipes on the Medivac, those few Marines and Marauders that have been dropped on standard chance. And in the middle of the map, another set of units has to stim again, losing hit points and backing off.
Yeah. Bjorn, though, playing this very carefully, and look at this, even more gateways going down here. it looks to be that we are going to see a big timing attack at the third base of Bian.
Oh yeah, he's definitely moving out with this. He's going into 10 gateways right now. Actually, even more.
Yeah,
he's getting like 12 of them. Legend just counted
yeah,
it out,
12.
But I didn't see it. Like 12.
Yep. 12, exactly. You're right. And this is with 2-2 upgrades. Way before Bian's 2-2 is going to be done, he may have attack during the fight, but he's not going to have the armor.
Yeah, we have him with the Archons now to lead the charge, and of course the Zealots are also here to enforce that. The upgrade, the attack upgrade is nearly completed. And, well, the Ghost Academy doesn't really have to come into play here. Of course, it would be nice for him to use DMPs against Archons and the shields of the rest of the gateway units. But he doesn't need snipes, he doesn't need anything against Storm. But those two Colossi alone can do a lot of damage with all that stuff that is guarding them on the ground.
It looks like he's going to pressure here, but I don't think he's going to commit. He knows that there's a lot at the top of the ramp. Well, goes up here, and Bian is actually a little bit out of position. He was down the bottom of the other ramp.
Oh, but those Colossi get a lot of hits here. The Vikings are not threatened by those Archons at all, but the SCVs that he brought over from the right side, they certainly got a handful.
Immortals being targeted here, very nicely done by both players. The Archons at the back, they are the real damage dealers right now. Bian's army so low on hit points.
A lot of SCVs killed, and once again, they're all at the front, and the Archons, they are getting their shots off. More reinforcements streaming in.
Here
come those Zealots charging in immediately.
Oh, this is perfect for Super. He's getting so much done here, and he has the ability to transition back at home, but I don't even think he has to. I think he's going to end it right now.
Workers killed, nearing 40 here for the Protoss player. Bian is dropping in supply, and he GG's out of the game. Super taking it. His defense against Bian's aggression was strong enough. The early Nexus working out for him in the end. Great play here by Super. Very, very well played.
Yeah. Really, really good. Bian playing a good game as well, but Bian is just having a problem with this matchup. Whenever I see him play it, I just feel like he's got some mental block there. It's not like he's got a 30% win ratio in Hardest Form or anything like that, but he just seems to be a little bit blocked in the past few weeks here. Every Protoss he faces, just even if he looks strong in the game, he just gets killed by something, whether it's the Zealot run-bys or a strong timing. That was a really, really executed, well-executed push by
His strongest matchup is still the matchup against Terra, and his mirror matchup is always so strong, and the builds that he executes there have, of course, been like amazing, not only in Wings of Ludo, but also in Heart of the Swarm. For him, it's really a problem that he doesn't face any Terrans in this group. I think he would have loved to play a few opponents in the mirror matchup. Today, he has only to face a few Protosses and, of course, the Zerg players here. But Super played this really well. The aggression by Bian, I mean, that was really heavy. That was a lot. All those drops that were going on, the run-bys towards the third base. But he did that very, very well. I never forgot to neglect his macro game and going to those additional upgrades. So that was a very strong attack that we saw, gearing up with all those gateways, hitting the upgrades, and then moving in. Really well executed, and it gives him a lead in the group.
Yeah, it definitely does just give him that momentum he needs to go into the rest of this group. I'm still just thinking about that attack. It was perfectly executed. The timing there, right before 2-2 is done, he has enough Archons to lead the charge, and the Archons are there to push Bian back. He has to stim a lot, run into the corner, and that's when the next wave of Zealots with the 12 gateways come into play. I didn't think he was going to commit when Bian was at the top of the ramp, but then he went down the other ramp, and he was like, well, I've got this opportunity here. I'm definitely going to take it. This is what I wanted to hit.
He had to go for the timing. Everything else is then completely freestyle, and he wanted to execute his strategy as intended, and that's exactly what he did, and he won him the game. Now we're heading into our only ZBZ of the day. Curious, he already lost his first match, and he is up, of course, now against Effort in a ZBZ. That's going to be a really interesting game. Effort is a player that we haven't seen yet today. This is his first match.
Yeah, he looks really good with that new haircut he's got as well. I don't know about that one thing he's got sticking down his forehead suddenly, though, but just a moment ago, he looked great.
I wouldn't know.
You see what I'm talking about? It's a little tip that goes down his forehead.
It's alive.
It almost looks like it. Effort, the low rider Zerg, often sitting very low in his chair as the game goes on.
Yeah, and the game is going to be played on Red City. And speaking of it, we're jumping right into it. Here, the GSL up and downs Group D.
With Paul Dunwolf.